At the outset, I'll say that if you open your materials document, on the top of the index, it says title here and subtitle here. That means that Andy assumed when he rebuilt the index page that it was going to fill those in and didn't go in and change them. If it really bothers you, you please do a pen and ink change. Hopefully that won't be that big of an issue for any of our listeners out there. Again, we are going to be following through the materials more than the slides. I'm trying to refresh some slides now. Seeing a little bit of latency on my side, but in any case, as far as an overview goes, today we are focused on Reg Z. This is going to be basically the compensation is under 1026.36. So if you hear us talking about Reg Z, we're meaning particularly this section. There will be times that we will be doing some discussion about the SAFE Act, which is a different animal, but it relates to this. But generally, we're focusing it on that 1024 or 1026.36, starting to think a little bit about RESPA. So we do want to look at some of these issues. If you're on the materials, you should be open to page 2. And I do want to indicate that this is not, when we talk about lender compensation, we're not talking about something that's brand new. The Fed had originally come up with some rules. The Bureau, the CFPB, basically picked up with that and ran with it. Even in 2010, the Fed knew there were going to be some additional restrictions based on Dodd-Frank. That's what has been built in. Now, this rule came out in its final form, final being in italics and little air quotes, January 20th of 2013. That was the final rule. But it's like the Indiana Jones movie where he has that medallion burned into his hand. You've got to have the whole medallion because there were revisions on May 29th of 2013 and then again on September 13th of 2013. So just a few months prior to the implementation date. Some of that guidance was good for us, and in a lot of cases it's information that you have to have because it's information that you have to follow. Today's program is meant to give you an in-depth analysis of these rules. Is it going to answer every question during the presentation? Perhaps not. After the presentation, after you get the Q&A, as you sit down and look at the various resources and the materials that you have here, hopefully it is all going to be crystal clear and you're going to have a good understanding. But we still would expect that we're going to get some kind of clarifications as bankers have questions about, we do it this way, we do it that way. The examiners, hopefully the Bureau, will come out with additional guidance as needed. And we may have a couple of, we had some questions that were submitted earlier today that we've already, Mary Beth and I have talked a little bit about, and we can make a recommendation, but in some cases, there may be further guidance that comes down and influences those questions. So that may be one of the things that we want to look at. And again, one of the things that you'll hear us talk about when we talk about loan originators, we're going to be meaning mortgage loan originators are under the SAFE Act. Loan originators are what we're talking about primarily as we reflect on Regulation Z. It's unfortunate that we have so many terms that are so similar, but that's beyond our control. We have to play the hand that's going to be dealt to us by the Bureau. So this rule is not unique, as we have several other things like HPMLs and HPCTs and things that are very similar. So we have issues to deal with there. One of the first things that we want to look at is the effective date. When is the whole trigger going to get pulled here that you have to worry about this? Well, originally it was going to be on January 10th, but they came out with some clarifications and said, you know, basically they being the Bureau, they came out and said compensation packages don't generally start on January 10th. So perhaps we have to worry about when the lender's compensation is actually going to run, and usually that's going to be on a calendar year. So they said, okay, the requirements for these rules are going to be on January 1, 2014, instead of the original January 10th of 2014. However, the section that did not have an adjustment on that date is the section where we're going to talk about placing names and NIMSLR IDs on those documents. That remains in effect for January 10th, but I think that's one of the rules. There are a few that you can't implement early. I don't think it would hurt to implement that early. So that's one of the things that if you want to flip the switch on that, don't think you have any problems with that. You can say we're going to begin this now and we're going to follow the keep it simple method, or you can say no, we're going to wait till January 10th when we turn on so many other Dodd-Frank requirements. That's going to be up to your individual bank. It's one of the few choices that you'll get in a lot of this Dodd-Frank changes. We do have some resources, and one of the best resources is the BOL Alphabet Soup. There are so many times that a lender or a compliance officer, somebody who's working within the parameters of regulatory compliance, has printed materials. And how often are those being updated, and how often are the updates actually being filed? And that's a question that you have to answer within your own shop. The Alphabet Soup page is updated very quickly, usually within a day or two of the issuance of the rules. John Burnett is our guardian for the Alphabet Soup, and he just does a fantastic job updating that particular section of our page. So you can go in and you can look at Regulation Z. You can see what's pending. You can see what's been proposed, and you can see what has changed and what is effective and what the effective dates of those changes are. The real benefit there is that if you were looking at printed materials and you didn't have, you had the final rules from that were issued on loan originator compensation, but you didn't have one or both of the updates, well, those are on the electronic version. The downside is it's hard to use the highlighter on your screen. So you may want to print out some things that you save for reference. That's up to you. You've also got Federal Register documents that you can print out. Sometimes those are very helpful to either print out or to save on your computer to highlight on your own copies, because you'll have prefatory comments. And those prefatory comments can be extremely valuable because this is a new rule. And there are times that you have to sit back and say, well, I need to get in the mind of the Bureau. What were they thinking when they wrote this particular rule? And by looking at the prefatory comments, you'll be able to go in and see what was their thought process, where were they going, what was, you know, what led them to these conclusions, and that can sometimes help you render your opinions as far as what works and what doesn't, as far as how do we interpret this particular rule. Again, remember, there were three final rules, the January, the May, and the September rules that came out, so you've got to look at perhaps each of those as you work through phases on, you know, what changed and what came about, or zero in on the final and say, I'm not going to clutter my mind with those. This is what the bottom line is.
But I find it helpful, Andy, when I have something stuck in my mind and I'm thinking, but wait, I thought the rule said so-and-so, and being able to see what the original text was of the January 2013 rulemaking, and then to see what's been struck through because they made an amendment, and then look to see what the new language is that they've substituted in one of the subsequent rulemakings. That's comforting to me in thinking, okay, I did remember correctly. It's simply that they have changed it now.
And those are features that John does put on the Alphabet Soup, so it is easy to go in and see what changed. You know, and not just here's what changed, but here's what the actual substitution was that's replacing that paragraph, and that's very helpful. We do have special forms on Bankers Online, because there's more than you and the regulation to address these needs. You can network with your peers. You're not going to be the first person to have questions, and sometimes listening to other bankers, we had some peer conference calls yesterday. You can listen to other bankers and they'll bring up a point. You go, ooh, I hadn't thought about that side of it yet. So not only do you get an answer to a question, but you didn't even know you had that question yet. And another resource that's out there, I like videos, and the CFPB, the Bureau, has a channel for YouTube. So there are videos out there that can assist. You may be able.
It's those are better, I think, for people who don't need to know the fine points, the real details. But those videos can provide a great overview and a basic level of familiarity with the new rules.
That's right. They can provide a background.